Hello friends, now today we are going to start an important topic as far as the contract act is concerned. As you can see on the screen, on the board, consent and free consent. Section 13 defines consent. Section 14 defines free consent, which is in the negative. Consent is said to be free when it is not caused by. Section 15, coercion. Section 16, undue influence. Section 17, fraud. Section 18, misrepresentation. And Section 19, mistake. So Section 13 speaks about when two persons agree upon the same thing in the same sense, that is consent. That is identity of minds. If I want to sell my, say I have two cars, one red in color and one black in color. I intend to sell my red color to you, but you intend to purchase my black color car. So here there is no meeting of the minds. There is no identity of the minds. There is no consensus ad idem. So there is no consent. Now Section 14 speaks about free consent. And it is defined in the negative, as I told you. Consent is said to be free when it is not caused by. Consent is said to be free when it is not caused by. Number 1, coercion, Section 15. Number 2, undue influence, Section 16. Number 3, fraud, Section 17. Number 4, misrepresentation, Section 18. And number 5, mistake, that is Section 19, subject to the provisions of 20, 21 and 22. So as far as this question is concerned, people, what is consent? What is free consent? What are the ingredients of the free consent? You have to enumerate and write this Section 13, 14 and right from 15 to Section 19. Now what is coercion? When one person threatens or commits an offense which is forbidden by the Indian Penal Code, that is IPC, or detains any property of that person with the intention that the other person enters into the contract. That is coercion. What does that mean? Let me illustrate that with an example. Say I have a small kid. I have two kids, that's a different thing. So my elder daughter, say, she's 9 years, and you all know, let us presume that one of you know, that after 12 o'clock I'm not there at home. And during that period, what you do, you either kidnap my baby, or what you do is you threaten me that you are going to kidnap her. So threatening to commit that offense of kidnapping or actually committing that offense of kidnapping. So either you commit it or you threaten to commit it. And then you call me. So if you don't give me full marks in the internal examination, then your daughter will be kidnapped. So it's better that you give me full marks. So what you're doing, you're putting a proposal, but you are coercing me, you are compelling me to enter into a contract and agree to what you are proposing. So this is an example of what people coercion. We have seen Section 13, we have seen Section 14, we have seen Section 15. Now we'll go for Section 16, which is undue influence. Now to understand this concept of undue influence, one person should be in dominant position and the other person should be in an inferior position. The person who is in a dominant position takes undue advantage of a person who is in inferior position. Parents can have undue influence over their children. Doctors can have undue influence over their patients. police officers can have undue influence over accused. Spiritual gurus can have undue influence over devotees. So here, what examples I have given you, you will find that all these person, parents, doctors, police officers, spiritual gurus, all of them are in a dominant position, and the remaining are in an inferior position. So the person who are in a dominant position may take undue advantage of the person who are in inferior position. There is one case law, people, to make you understand this concept. There was a woman, and she was happily married. And once she met a priest, and the priest told her that in the next birth, if you want to go to heaven, renounce the world, dedicate everything religiously to the church. Accordingly, the lady gave all her belongings, all her property to the church. Now, after 9 years, she started serving the church. After a period of 9 years, for whatsoever reason best known to her, she wanted to again start her family life. And she requested the priest to give back some money or the property which she has given to the church. At that time, the priest told her that, "Don't do that. If you do that, you'll go to hell." And the lady wanted that amount because she wanted to start a new life, a new family life again. And she contended in the court of law that her consent was due to undue influence. Now here the priest was in a dominant position, that lady was in an inferior position, and here there was an undue influence. That means the priest had an undue influence over the lady. And of course, the lady won the case, stating the court held that there was an undue influence because here the priest was in a dominant position and the devotee, that the lady, was in an inferior position. So this was all about section 16, that is undue influence.